first, going back to Terminator, it all starts with James Cameron. I mean, for me, he is simply the greatest filmmaker alive. The movie was so far ahead of its time, and the thing that I actually really loved about it was that it wasn't just a great science fiction movie, it wasn't just a great man versus machine movie, it was actually a love story at the center of it.
At the heart of this great science fiction film is this real emotional story. I still remember watching the original Terminator and thinking way back then, oh wow, this is a love story. It's this incredible science fiction movie and Arnold Schwarzenegger is this killer robot and it's all incredibly cool. But for me, the movie always boiled down to the line, I came across time for you, Sarah.
There was no comparable female action. Not even like a hero, an archetype. I mean, I think that's the thing that Jim does just so beautifully, is he taps into this warrior goddess archetype. And Sarah was so, for me anyway, I just remember finding it a very revolutionary experience creatively.
For me, one of the things when we actually did get the rights to Terminator was, okay, why now? Because if you're going to do a newer version of a movie like this, you shouldn't just do it just because you bought the rights. It's how do you make it relevant? And for us, the why now has always been the technology.
You know, in the original film, Skynet had to bash through your front door, but today it's completely different. We line up days before the new iPhone comes out to basically go get the Apple Store to actually, you know, invite Skynet in through the front door. We're constantly giving away our privacy. We can't live without our phone.
If you look around a restaurant, how many people are actually talking to one another and how many people are looking down at devices? How much of our lives are absolutely dependent upon devices? And this movie basically poses the ultimate question of, at what point is the tipping point? And that is what Genesis is. Genesis is the moment of that tipping point.
A lot of people have asked this. There was no version of Terminator without Arnold Schwarzenegger. I mean, Arnold is the Terminator. It's his most iconic role.
But yes, it was incumbent upon us to try to figure out a way that you don't feel like you're just seeing him do a repeat of any of the other movies. And that was really important to all of us. We wanted to be very respectful of Arnold, and we wanted to be very respectful of the character that he created. I mean, it's a legacy character.
30 years ago, we started with that franchise, and I did not think then, when we did the first Terminator, there ever would be a sequel. But now, all of a sudden, here's the fifth. And not only the fifth, but 30 years later, you get asked to come back and to be the Terminator again. So this was really a fantastic kind of news to me, and I was honored that I was offered the role again. I'm still the Terminator 30 years later, so that was really extraordinary.
We had been writing a different project for David and Dana, you know, David Ellison at Skydance. And as we were finishing the first pass on that, they had been putting together the rights with Megan Ellison for doing a new Terminator film. I think they had talked to Lita a few times, in which she kept saying no. Yeah.
I didn't feel comfortable given my relationship with the person who had created the universe. It felt like, you know, mildly sacrilegious.
And then you changed your mind.
Well, I finally ended up talking to Jim about whether or not he thought I should do it. And he was incredibly supportive in a way that only someone with that level of creative generosity can be. You know, it's a world that he had left behind, and he felt that I should, if I wanted to go ahead and do it, that it would not be anything that he felt would hurt the franchise.
The writer is a good friend of mine, Lita Kalogridis, and she has a writing partner, Patrick, that she works with now. But she and I have written together in the past. So she kind of asked me to, you know, unofficially advise, you know, and I said, look, the thing that's most clear to me is, I think, the Terminator. There's a way to explore his character that could actually be fun and open it up more while still giving fans what they want. And it has to do with this idea that he's not really a robot. He's a cyborg. He has a robotic endoskeleton, but he's the org part of cyborg is an organic organism. So he's got living human tissue over the outside. And so that would age. And so the idea that Arnold, now as a 60-something, is playing the same character that he played back when he was in his late 30s, or mid-30s, I guess, is perfectly plausible in that world, if you buy into the conceits of that world.
You know, the construction of the story, it wasn't about, you know, creating a reboot. It wasn't about creating something that nullified the films that have gone before. It was about creating a story that could work in concert with what happened before. One of the first things we came up with and pitched was the Arnold and Arnold fight, the idea of old Arnold fighting young Arnold, and how that would pay respect to the original world that Jim created literally in a shot-by-shot manner, and then deviate and show the left turn that we were going to go and how we were going to continue on in different directions.
And we also started from a place of, for us, a Terminator universe is always going to have fundamental aspects to it. In this case, it's always going to have a Sarah Connor, it's always going to have a Kyle Reese, it's always going to have a John, and it's always going to have a Terminator. They just may not resemble the versions that you've seen previously. And, you know, that did lead ultimately to what is the big twist in our movie.
I would say it was much more Patrick's sort of inspiration, because I was too afraid to push the story that far at that point.
Up to the moment we were going to have a meet with Skydance and pitch them the ideas that we were beginning to germinate, that morning kept thinking, what do you do with the savior of the world? How do you take him on a journey that is unexpected? And what, from Skynet's point of view, is a thing that always trips Skynet up?
That is the most important part to me, is if you are Skynet and you are an AI and a learning machine,
you realize that there, because of the loops of time travel, time travel loops and loops and loops and loops, and so at some point in that loop, Skynet figures out the thing that always makes it lose is John Connor. And if I want to win, well, I need one of those. And if I can't make one of those, take it, and I will co-opt it, and I will make it be mine. So thought of that in the morning. You know, it's one of those things where you're in the shower, and you're like, oh, what if we do that? I remember calling Lita, so I have this crazy idea. Oh, yeah, and Lita was like, well, I don't know if we could do that. That's what I was saying. We had talked about maybe infecting Kyle and have that infection sort of going out over the period of the movie, and it's sort of a gradual thing. And the call ends, and we haven't decided if it's going to be that way or not. And
I can't believe you're actually going to tell this story.
And then we go into the pitch meeting, and we're sitting there, and Lita starts pitching, and
lo and behold,
I have no idea which version she's going to pitch. And suddenly she pitches, and then John is, you know, the villain is co-opted by Skynet and becomes, and they were like, oh, that's it. And it was just like, oh crap, I guess we're doing that one.
Now, the idea of taking John Connor and flipping him to the bad guy and showing, you know, basically a synthesis of a human being and an artificial intelligence, that character is really, really fun to watch and really fun to explore what the emotional repercussions of that would be with Sarah, with the Terminator, and with Kyle Reese, because they all have relationships with John Connor that all have to be rewritten as a result of what happens in this film.
You said all the other subjects died, right? Well, that means John's one of a kind. He's unique, all right? There's no way I know what he's capable of.
You're right, and that's what makes him so dangerous. John is not humanity's last hope anymore. He's Skynet's.
There's phenomenal action in Terminator movies, and we plan to live up to that promise. But a lot of people can shoot action. Not a lot of people can really get true character-driven performances in the middle of, again, a giant science fiction film.
I love and worship at the altar of Game of Thrones. To me, it simply redefined what you can do on television. And Alan Taylor was a massive part of those first few seasons.
You never approached directly about things. I was finishing my last movie, and I came in to have a meeting with Skydance, who had been developing it for years with Megan Ellison. And we had a general meeting, and we talked about a bunch of things, and they mentioned Terminator, but I never thought they were mentioning it for me. And then we had a meeting a week later, and it was all about Terminator. And at that point, it was equal parts, you know, oh my God, excitement, and also, oh my God, how on earth, you know, do I step up to that? knowing that Arnold was going to be in this and that he's aged and he's a different guy now, the excitement for me was to really embrace that and say, we're not going to brush that under the table. We're not going to pretend. We're going to explore, you know, what does it mean for a machine to be trapped in a timeline with no access to future technology? What's going to happen to that machine over time? That was the key to finding a new thing to do with Arnold in that role. It's a source of humor in the movie. It's also a source of pathos. Your heart goes out to him. And so that was exciting. The first creative sort of teammate I reached for was Kramer Morgenthau, who had been my DP on various things. We met on Boardwalk Empire. I took him into Game of Thrones, and then we did Thor together. So there was sort of a shorthand and a camaraderie there. And I love his work, and I think he can make things look epic and beautiful.
The pre-production process on this picture was tremendously involved and, huge amount of moving parts. Working very closely with Neil, the production designer, and figuring out the places where practical photography leaves off and virtual photography takes over.
Neil Spisak came on as our production designer, and I'd never worked with him before, but we just sort of met people, and I loved the way he talked about the worlds.
That's how much space we have. I know you included the pillar. That's Big Bear.
Okay.
But what I like about this one, you know,
the entire concept of really turning a ruined LAX into the opening sequence where the Future War took place was entirely Neil's idea. And he came in with these phenomenal renderings that he had done of it, and it was just like kind of all of our jaws hit the ground, and we're like, this has to be the guy for the movie.
I think our helicopter should be gray.
Oh, this is a Future War star?
Future War, yeah. Okay.
And he had some real challenges in evolving things that had existed, like the hunter killers and the spider tanks, but making them cool for our time. And we're creating our time displacement device, which had been referred to but never seen before.
Kramer, of course, likes.
I like Kramer has
the darker.
Two ideas. One, when they come back to the third act, it'll probably look like this.
One of the major points of the design of this movie is that we travel through different realities, and finding a way to keep them separated and to make it clear as to which reality you're in at which time. So the 1980s is a more saturated palette, more colorful palette. And the 2017 will be very real and yet modern. There is a pretty strong color control in terms of its gray palette. So there's a sort of cleanness to it, I guess, especially because of so much of it being about Cyberdyne.
I mean, Neil came in from moment one, and same as Kramer, with such a respect for the Cameron films. You know, so many of the people who worked on this movie felt such a responsibility to want to live up to those films. The look, the palettes, you know, sort of the tones, but we have to stand on our own two feet.
Obviously, we were massive, massive set builds on this movie. Every single time you walked onto one of his sets, they were jaw-dropping. Neo literally rose to the challenge. The film would not be what it is without the amazing work that he did.
We're at Legacy Effects. We're here in the process of building Terminators. And once again, for me, this is a really neat thing because my first big movie, the first movie that I count, was the first Terminator. I've worked on all of them, and so it's quite an honor to be involved again with this. So what's pretty neat is to see the evolution of the technology that has gone into particularly creating these endoskeletons. And the rapid prototyping process and sculpting, you know, digitally in the computer has given us a sense of symmetry and machine preciseness that is so different than how it was originally done, when it was all sculpted by hand in clay, then molded, then all the pieces taken out, painstakingly hand sanded and redone. And you know, you look back at it fondly because it was such an iconic character, but the precision and the cleanness and how we've created these things now is really remarkable.
When it comes to practical and creature effects, there is nobody that does a better job in our industry than Legacy. And the amount of love, respect, and brilliance that they brought to the project has been all of their work. Literally, there was no question to us that they had to be a part of this.
We were updating some of the look of some of our creatures. The T-800 endoskeleton is adapted a little bit, and they were so familiar with Arnold, which is a big part of it. He was the first fully body scanned actor, I think, way back when they were doing it last time, so they still have that around. And just the use of prosthetics on him was always kind of flawless, and a lot of talk about how much can you damage Guardian, how much can you damage Arnold, you hang on to the humanity in this creature. They already had a vocabulary for that because they'd been through it before.
This is the model that we received from client before any process. It's pretty elaborately modeled as is, but there's still a lot of stuff that is required to finish it to make it a viable, tangible object. This is the chest of the T-800, and it's basically broken down into logical parts for assembly. All the different colors represent the different parts that we have grown and how we've actually broken it apart for the process of building.
The final endoskeleton is made out of various kinds of epoxies and urethanes and rubbers, but that stuff is not self-supporting as far as strength goes, so we had to put a skeleton inside of that that's mostly made out of precision machined aluminum. This would be the spine, the neck. This is where the skull of the endoskeleton goes, and this is one of his arms. We don't know whether they're gonna ever be used as puppets or not, but we like to set them up so that they could potentially be puppets, so all of these individual joints can lock off like a traditional rod puppet so that it could be performed on set if it needed to be.
So this is a special build for a stunt mask, but we did the full endoskeleton same way. Most of it was 3D printed in-house. I have up on the monitor right now the skeleton. It was real nice and satisfying actually being able to print something like this.
We're standing in the model shop. We do all the finish work on the rapid prototype parts that come off the beds. We do all the finishing of the parts as far as sanding the parts, sanding all the lines off the parts, prepping them for the molding process. And then once all these castings are done, they come back into here and the guys start doing the final assembly. And that's what Toy is doing here. He's taking the skull to the T-800 and he's cleaned it all up and he's putting all the final little details back in, including the eyes and, you know, all the parts that are needed to create this final piece. Nick is doing final assembly here on the arm. I would say there was approximately 50 pieces to this arm. So you can see here the fingers are articulated, positionable, and yet they're quite flexible, you can see here, even though they look metallic. And the wrist is also articulated, move from side to side.
What's kind of neat about this one is that, you know, all the other endos, you know, from part 1, 2, and 3, all those were all chrome plated, and this one is just a paint treatment, which I thought was pretty neat. From head to toe, every little nook and cranny that you see in here has to get a black wash on it. And you can tell from where I did do it already, where it looks darker than where I haven't done it on the chest, which is real bright. And then wipe it off and just let the black settle into the lines. And that just pulls out, you know, all the detail. You get to see all the cool lines and all the nice shapes and forms a lot better when you have a black line defining everything for you.
wanted to introduce you guys to the T-800 endoskeleton. This is one of three endos that we're gonna have on the show. This being the Hero. This one will be mostly for lighting for these actual CG walking characters. But every now and then, I'm sure we'll get a shot off where, you know, we have an insert piece or something of that nature. So that's why we wanted to try to make them as articulated as possible. So if we had to, we could literally have them go in, you know, do an insert shot of an arm coming in or something. We have a nice bearing so we can have easy movement in the waist. And the head has a ball and socket joint so we can get all kind of movement out of this. This one's mostly epoxy and some urethane parts. Our stunt one over here, which the guys are hard at work on, has to be a little more pliable. This one's foam, it's a 280 foam. It still has the aluminum armature, so we still get the same articulation out of all the joints. It just doesn't have the rigidity of the Hero one. So if it falls out of the truck, which it's gonna do in the film, it's not gonna shatter.
And door!
Basically what we're doing is the rest of the crew here is catching this one up to the same level as this. So when they're done, you won't be able to tell them apart.
Then we're doing an old 1984 Arnold recreation of him.
So this is all sculpted traditionally the same way in clay, the whole body. It took me about, I think about 4 weeks to do. I got as much reference of Arnold as I could, and I sculpted it over a scan of Arnold from, I think, 2002, 2003. So he was in his 50s, so I took that, which gave me all the proportions of Arnold, and then from photo reference, I had to go back in and bulk him back up as he was in 1983. After, I think he had just finished his last Mr. Olympian, so he was pretty buff at that point. So it was going back in, making all the proportions, all the muscles there, but then going in and mapping all the veins in and making sure it's as accurate as we could make it. This is a sculpture done that we actually did from Terminator 4 that we reworked for this new one. This was Arnold back in 1984. This is based on old life casts that we had and photographs and stuff. And then this is a life cast of Arnold that was taken a few months ago at age 67. So I think he's 38 here and 67 here. It's soft silicone to a certain degree, and then it's rigid foam inside. And then in the stomach, it's deeper, so it can flex and move, and everything can, you know, move around naturally. Like, you know, we have the neck, and on the day when this is like a, you know, when it's dead Terminator, we'll pose this in whatever pose we want and we can lock it off. It took us about 2-3 days to put the endoskeleton inside the head and the chest wounds and all the different various wounds, and then all the hair. The wig is all hand tied from here back on lace, and then the whole front edge, as you can see, is all punched in one hair at a time. See how fine that is? And then styled and cut, and then all the eyebrows are punched and the eyelashes are punched and curled as well. I did the whole body, and then the legs are based off the same mold. So I think we're doing 12 pair of legs that are gonna have a frozen look, and they're gonna be hanging in the factory.
I'm working on Terminator legs here, and we're casting them out of Platsil Gel 10, which is a platinum silicone, non-toxic, and it has been tinted to look like skin. It's a two-part silicone that when added together, you'll have a pot life or a working time of about 5 minutes. And it has a very flesh-like feel to it, which makes it perfect for using for legs.
You brush them in a layer at a time, and then you build it up to the point where you can put the steel armature in so that it can move. And then you backfill that with a foam so that it's got a nice squishy natural feel to it. We can do about one a day. It takes about probably six hours maybe.
When the piece comes out of the mold, it obviously has a seam line on it. And our job is just to erase that so it doesn't look fake. The hardest thing to pull is obviously the human eye. You know, if there's a few little dotted line of a seam, the mine actually fills it in. You always see the line, so you really got to work hard to confuse it and hide it. We're just mixing up some material and putting it over the edge and smoothing it out
And then once we've done that, let me go back over and try and match the texture that the sculptors have done.
So what's going on right now is we need to make a stunt mask that looks like Arnold. So we scanned Arnold some time ago, we've cleaned up that scan, and now we've prepped the geometry to be 3D printed. I can open up the hood to give a little bit more insight. So it's printing right now face down at a 16 micron level, which is smaller than one of my piece of hairs. With every layer that goes back and forth, that's one of the layers of the geometry building it up. And as it goes on, those lights cure it to bring it to a hard state. And then once it gets 3D printed, it'll be handed over to a makeup artist slash sculptor to bring out even more detail in it. In this scenario, Arnold's gonna take about 29 hours to print his full face. So we have just about 29 hours left. It pretty much just started. So tomorrow afternoon, we'll have Arnold in our hands.
And we're also doing lots of prosthetic appliances. This is a big part of the Terminator movies, always have been.
So here we have a map to what the makeup is eventually going to be like. There's five different stages to the Arnold makeup. In each new stage, there's anywhere between 3 and 6 new appliances added. So he starts out with the basic Arnold Guardian. Then he'll get a couple of new scars. Then we go to phase B, new scars being added. Stage C, looks like there's 9 more scars being added, all the way up to the point where he becomes the really disfigured Terminator. This is a glue that we glue appliances on the face with, and what we're doing here is we're making a self-sticking appliance. We're taking this liquefied glue and turning it in front of a little bit of heat and air for hours and creaming it to like almost like a peanut butter paste. We figured out with our acrylic colors and some flocking the proper color to match to Arnold Schwarzenegger's skin tone. So once this is a nice thick peanut butter, we'll take this and put it into molds that we have outside that I'll show you now. So what Ken's doing here is he's just spatulating the prosthetic into the mold, making sure there's no air bubbles, getting all the detail captured. And once the prosthetic's in there, a nice even level, he's gonna take the acetate plastic, he's burping out all the airs, and he's gonna create a blend edge that'll blend down to Arnold's face. Now the next step is this is gonna have to go in the freezer for about an hour and chill. As you can see here, we have dozens of pieces that are in the works. This one's ready to come out. So once these are frozen nice and solid, we carefully peel the mold off. And here's the appliance, but it'll never really go translucent. So what we have to do is we take this appliance, we put it into a convection oven or dehydrator for days. Then once it comes out of the oven, it'll go into our box and it'll get shipped to set for application.
When I look back to what, you know, we did back then with a small group of people, you know, it's a classic film. But, you know, technically, you keep getting better and the bar keeps getting raised. And so the standards keep going up. And, you know, it's very photoreal now, the way the appliances are being done. And then what's genius about it now, what we couldn't do back then, was the blending of the CG with the prosthetics. You know, with prosthetic appliances, you can only build up onto the skin. You can't take away. So what's fantastic, and we did this actually back on T3 for the first time, was, you know, removing from the actor, which you can do, you know, utilizing the combination of CG and the appliances. So it's, you know, bringing to bear all the state-of-the-art tricks of the trade to, you know, make this movie really special.
Thank you. thing that was so exciting for me at the beginning of Terminator was that I got to recreate 1984. So I knew when I spoke with Ellen, our director, that I needed to match that opening shot of Griffith Park Observatory. I started with the punks. I called everybody. I was looking for those costumes. I even called Arnold Schwarzenegger and said to him, do you have those costumes? Who has the costumes? And the thing is, when they did the very first Terminator, they didn't know when they were shooting it that they had something that was going to become a monumental success and kind of a part of the history of sci-fi film. So it turns out that nobody had these costumes. Probably someone's wearing it today and doesn't even know that it was in Terminator.
Your clothes, give them to me, now.
You won't be needing any clothes.
So it was very important to Alan and myself that when Arnold walks up behind the naked young T-800 Terminator, that you didn't know in the first couple seconds who it was walking up behind him. The thing that Alan insisted upon from the very beginning was that he said, I want a hood on Arnold. And the question was, how can you have Arnold playing the Terminator not wearing leather in the opening shot? So I tried hoods with leather, hoods that were fabric. And eventually we settled on a combination between a custom-made leather jacket from Matchless in England, and I worked together with them to have these jackets built, integrating a hood so that Arnold could walk up. You wouldn't know who it was. You would just see this massive, imposing figure, and then he could drop the hood. Kind of pleases both camps, the hood, the leather, Terminator.
I've been waiting for you.
We adore Susan. Yeah. We did Jack Reacher with her prior, and one of my favorite moments on Reacher was literally when she was doing research by literally sitting in bars trying to
figure out in Pittsburgh
how these people would dress and what kind of jacket Reacher would wear. And I mean, when you say dedicated, you will never find a human being more dedicated to perfection than Susan Matheson.
I believe she cut 70 versions of the jacket that Tom ultimately wore in Jack Reacher. And she didn't do quite as many for Arnold's jackets in this film, but she did a lot.
Well, anyone who's watched T1 knows that Kyle Reese arrives naked in an alley, steals the pants of a homeless guy. He goes running down an alley, runs into a discount department store, and what does he find there? He finds a military trench and a pair of Nike Vandal sneakers. Because we were going back to 1984, I knew, even though it was an alternate version of 1984, that Kyle Reese had to find these exact items.
There's a kind of iconic shot that the fans will recognize when Kyle Reese puts the shoe on in 1984. And I really wanted to get that exact frame. Susan was being sort of rebuffed for a while by Nike, and finally she just steamrolled them. And as a result, we have the very shoe being recreated by Nike for us.
They are an exact replica, down to the color and the Velcro straps.
One of the most important things about landing the role for me was, once I found out that it was mine, I was on the phone to the wardrobe department immediately to find out if we were bringing back the Nike Vandals, and was told we were. And I was in. That's when I signed.
We were recreating the jacket, and two of the people in my department went thrift store shopping, and they walked in and they found the exact jacket from the original Terminator, because it turns out that the jacket that Kyle Reese wore was actually a trench coat from the military that was very popular in the 80s. And the people used to wear them with their Doc Martens and their jeans and the trench coat. It was something that was very common in the 80s, but it's now very, very difficult to find. So once we realized that it was an existing military jacket, the hunt was on to try to find these jackets everywhere.
You think he's dead, don't you?
Sarah Connor in Terminator Genisys is a completely different Sarah Connor. We're back in 1984, but this is not the same Sarah Connor that Linda Hamilton was in 1984. So it's a complete paradigm shift for me in terms of design for Sarah Connor. Because when we meet her, she is battle ready. She already knows the exact date and time that Kyle Reese is going to appear. So I started to look at what was iconic in 1984 for a tough chick who's ready for battle. We were steeped in punk rock culture at the time. Almost every woman who was interested in punk rock culture had a leather biker jacket, almost like Arnold in T1. And so I thought this would be a great way of kind of connecting these characters and these movies by putting her in a leather biker jacket. And of course, what did women wear at the time on their feet if they were steeped in kind of wanting to be feminine but tough and part of the punk rock culture? Well, they wore Doc Martens. So in 1984, she's wearing a leather jacket, she's wearing cargo pants and some Doc Martens, and she's ready to kick ass. One of the challenges with Arnold in Terminator Genesis is that every costume he wears needs to be iconic, but there's such a different place that this character is coming from. The surprise is that there's actually four changes in this movie for Arnold in terms of clothing. And we see him in 84, we see him in the 70s, then we see him twice in San Francisco in two different looks. When we first meet him in San Francisco, we meet him at the hospital. And it was so important that what he wore when he walked into the hospital, that he looked like someone visiting a patient at the hospital so that he would not arouse suspicion. He's wearing kind of an olive drab jacket and some jeans and construction worker boots. And so he almost looks like, you know, maybe he's been doing construction for the last 33 years.
Go try the nurse's room.
You know, for me, it's painful going anywhere other than his classic leather look, but it was so important to the storyline that he not give away that he was a Terminator. And then we have an opportunity later on in the Battery Tunnels where he then changes into tactical fighter gear and he becomes that Terminator character again. He was a great collaborator because every time I would start going here, Arnold would say, no, you need to go here. And the greatest thing about fitting Arnold was when I first met him, I was thinking, well, you know, he's a little older than he was in the 80s. What are we gonna do about his look and, you know, how to make him look formidable? Well, about a month later, I had another fitting with Arnold and I walk in and he says to me, I have the same measurements now as 1984. He had completely transformed himself in a month. And I said to him, have you been working out? And he looked at me and he said, no. Because the thing about Arnold, he's a great joker. And that's the thing I've discovered about him. He will, as they say, really take the piss out of you. One of the most exciting aspects of getting asked to design Terminator Genesis was the future war. Knowing that I would have this entire world that I could create from nothing. One of the places that I started with was, okay, we're looking at Los Angeles culture from the 90s and what would have happened before an apocalypse. And then I started looking at all guerrilla fighters in the world today. And what do guerrilla fighters wear when they're fighting? You wear what you can find and you use it in a way that works for you. So for example, I've got arm pieces that are California license plates. We took tires and repurposed them into arm pieces and shoulder pieces. And he's got an interesting, very blocky shield. Come look at this one.
That's awesome.
He's got some paintball, actually he's got motocross armor on. And we made all of these pieces. So it's a really interesting group of guerrilla fighters because you've got 350 people that essentially every single person is dressed differently.
On this day, we take back our planet! Yeah!
Then we have the John Connors and the Kyle Reeses of that world. They are the elite officers. And so what's happened is you think if a community is at war, well, you're going to take the most highly functional things and you're going to put energy into that and supporting the elite fighters and give them the cargo pants and the things that you found that might be the most highly functional. So what we did was, together with Diana Burton and props, we built chest pieces that were good for plasma rifle hits. And then we built a lot of other pieces, you know, shoulder pieces, elbow pieces, knee pieces. And then based on the kind of fighting that they're doing and then the weapons that they have, their outfits modify according to that. This one is actually John Connor. You can see his initials, JC, on it. He has this kind of very futuristic looking protective shoulder piece. There's a secret that I'm gonna let you in on, which is that my crew discovered car mats. If you start cutting up your car mats, you'll land up with some great armor that works really well for camera. And if you can see the back of it, you know, it's been cut up and then riveted together, and the rivets have been aged and made rusty. This is also a car mat that had a piece of metal in it, but when you patina it, sand it, put it through the cement mixer, if you look up close here, you can really see what a cement mixer does, because the rubber has gotten patinaed in the crevices and there's like a white dust, and it really starts to look like it's gone through a post-apocalyptic nuclear war.
Especially in this movie, function was really important. You know, each and every one of them, to their own extent, is a soldier. And then you have Arnold, who's a machine. And so, yes, you want them to look good, to say the least, but anything they wear, they're going to wear for a reason. And that was something Susan latched onto, you know, within moments of saying, yes, I desperately want to do this movie because I love science fiction and I want to do a big science fiction film. And she just blends that beautifully. Beauty and functionality. And we were thrilled with the results. And so was Arnold, and he's none too easy to please.
One of the things we're staying very true to is the practical action that we have in this movie is massive. We have a Golden Gate Bridge chase sequence that took 15 days to shoot. We have a gigantic future war in this movie. The third act fight with John and Guardian at the end is massive. So the scope and scale of this truly is as big as anything we've ever made.
You're dealing with robots, and you're dealing with, you know, flying HK drones and spider tanks. So you know you're gonna get CG, but I do think there's also an expectation of practical stunt work. And this movie truly is a blend of both.
Terminator in particular has this kind of scale of combat, which is specific, I think. There's a way in which Arnold, as the T-800, fights. It's big and broad and heavy, and, you know, Arnold himself said, it's Terminator, you have to go big.
He knows better than anybody how to move, so they had the doubles matching what he's doing and keeping that theme of what he's always had.
There we go.
And so we haven't changed that in any way. You know, he's getting up there in age, he's still at it. He just still wants to do whatever he can. He's done quite a bit on this.
3, 2, 1, go!
Pops!
A lot of people ask me always the question, is this, okay, so this is a different Terminator movie, this is a different script, it's a different story, it's a different director, different producers, everything's different. I mean, what was different in the way you had to prep for this movie? And, you know, especially now that you are, you know, 67 years old versus, you know, 35 years old or 40 years old, I mean, there must be a difference. And the fact of the matter is that I have really kept in shape all the time. I train every day, I lift weights every day, I do my bicycle riding, my cardiovascular training and all this. And for a movie like that, inevitably you have to gain some weight because this is what the character was, the way it was written. The flesh and the look and the hair and all this kind of changes over the years, but not the skeleton. The metal skeleton is still the same frame, so you have to have the same size. So I had to have the same body weight again as I did with the original one, which was around 228, 230 pounds. So I gained that weight back, trained harder, and lifted more weights, heavier weights, and so on. And so we went through that kind of a training, and then working with the stunt coordinators and with the stunt people to do the actual training for the stunts and choreographing of the stunts, because there were tremendous, you know, fight scenes.
Action.
Oh,
Amelia, I already knew she was a tough cookie. I've been in the wilds of Malta with her standing naked surrounded by dragons, so I know how tough she can be. But I think, you know, her of all people had the biggest challenge.
I think Emilia Clarke has really had her hands full, because anyone that takes on a role like that and has to live up to the kind of standard of a Linda Hamilton, you know, this is a tough act to follow. And she dove into this whole thing, and she did the weight training, and she got a trainer for martial arts, and she got a trainer for the bodybuilding and the fitness training, and then worked with the stunt guys. So she really went all out.
And coming up.
She's game for anything. She was happy to come into the stunt stage and kind of, you know, was always excited to do more, more, more.
They had me preparing for this for a while, to not only get into sort of physically understanding what was needed for the role. For Sarah as a character, she was brought up by a Terminator to be a warrior, so she's got a huge body of knowledge when it comes to survival and fighting. So there was a lot of stuff that was kind of needed just to feel comfortable embodying that within and kind of walking with Sarah and always being prepared.
Come with me if you want to live.
I think that Jai Courtney was a perfect pick because he was like a strong guy. He has played this kind of roles before, very athletic. And he got really pumped up. He was terrific with the fight scenes and with all the action sequences. And you know, and he's at that age where he just loved doing all the action.
Jai was already able to do anything they threw at him. I mean, he was ridiculously
Jai
fit.
Could play a machine. I mean he's
so
relentless.
Strong.
And then some of the horrible things that were done to him.
It's the hang upside down and throwing.
I mean, I think he had the worst of it because he was the most capable. They realized he was the one that, well, just, you know, yeah, hang him. Don't hang anybody else.
He'll be fine.
You know, we'll put him in the harness. We'll make it so he's the one.
Yeah.
And honestly, you want this to feel like a football player just sacks somebody. I mean, like, the impact needs to be violent and aggressive.
No,
this just feels really, really soft.
Break it up.
There are empty ones. You control the energy by putting a steel plate on it, and it forces all the explosion to come back with it, and it breaks the glass. It makes the temper just go crazy.
Be better. We're also going to go to 100 mil or a 75 instead of a 50, so it's less. They compress it some more.
Yep. And then she's a little closer. I mean, if you don't buy that.
Yep. Yep.
Okay.
Be Mark.
Smug it up, Dave. All right, run away. Here we go. And 3, 2, 1, action!
Billy, Malik, you good?
Oh, that's great. Are you okay, though? You got some. Oh, that's good.
You want to turn this
thing off? I've got some of this.
It was good. Yeah. Alan Taylor is such an expert with action because he has done those kind of movies before, so he knew exactly what he was doing, and it was really great to feel like protected by him because he knew how to work with the visual effects people, the special effects people, the stunt coordinators, and the camera crew, and everyone, how to mold it all together and create this synergy so that he can create great scenes and then make it all work.
Yeah, the farthest you can extend it, the better. Right. Maybe even two hands.
Right.
Ready and action.
Jera, go!
Well, there's guns. I'm not sure if I mentioned the guns. But I'm gonna mention them now. There's firing guns, which is cool.
Amelia Clark and Jai Courtney had to go through a lot of training to, you know, work with those weapons. For Arnold, it's just like, you know, second nature. I think no gun was big enough. We had an armorer named Harry Liu, who was a, kind of a genius of weaponry that kind of kept everybody, you know, in check.
The important thing in a Terminator movie is always that you have a long range of kind of weapons, a wide variety of different weapons.
Well, this is the Guardian's munitions bunker. This is where he's been stockpiling weapons for several decades.
I think there are probably more guns on that set than on many military bases.
This set has probably 500 weapons, I would
say,
right?
Yeah, between rubbers and replicas and real and collectible period pieces. Right.
And also some of the guns from the other movies that we were trying to incorporate into this set in particular when the camera panned and we saw this.
The M79.
The M79, and we've got the minigun here.
Yeah.
When I first started, I met Harry out in California with the director and the producers, and we went through the script and we discussed all the weapons. And ultimately, we wanted to introduce some new weapons, clearly, because that's a very important part of the story.
The problem we had early on is that the vision of what the future weapons are.
If the machines are designing weapons, they don't care about design, really. They care about function. So we had to sort of become machines ourselves when we were thinking about what kind of guns that they would create. This could be maybe my favorite one. This one was the original leaf blower. This is a plasma gun that was created by the future, the endoskeletons. Happy with the weight of it. It weighs about 30 pounds. This gun was used by Kyle Reese in the Future War also. This is based on an AK-47 technology, so it fired beautifully, and we designed it based on that gun because of the reliability of it. And again, you know, we've got our plasma tech down here, and in theory, the guerrillas made these based on things that they could find. But we also wanted to bring with us some of the history of the franchise, and we would keep true to the guns that the Guardian has used in the past. And typically, the guns that he likes to use are
the shotguns. The Guardian shotguns are separate by era. So in the 80s, his shotgun is a Remington 1100, and that is proper for the period. It's functional and it is slick. And I have to say, you know, with a lot of input from Arnold, and that he loved it, and we shot it, and we shot a lot of that, and without any single malfunction. And for the 2017 segment,
motorcycle.
Shit!
We have a M3 Benelli and also an M4 Benelli. And both are also beautiful shotguns, and they're representing the high-tech part of the product. And once again, not a single jam, okay?
Hold on the gun, please, Harry. Let's roll camera.
See, it is off.
112 Georgie, take one, A and B.
Hey.
Action!
The key thing is as you shoot, and it makes this bang, this loud noise, then you don't blink, because machines don't blink, right? So therefore, you have to really be trained, and you have to do it over and over again. It's all through reps that eventually the brain understands that not to flinch when you shoot. So I was able to master that after, again, training it very hard and practicing a lot.
For Sarah Connor, she is a much different character in this movie. And the first gun that we see her with is a 50 caliber Barrett. Again, it's proper for 1984. And this weapon posed a few problems for us because it had to serve two different purposes. It had to be a sniper rifle that could take down a Terminator from far away. And also blow off the back of a armored truck door at fairly close range.
The length of the barrel, oh my goodness. We talk and we brainstorm and, you know, what can we maneuver inside the vehicle?
What can we maneuver inside a Brinks truck, which you'd think is big? It is not that big. So this was what we chose, and it worked out very, very well.
Lots of guns, lots of guns, and then some more guns, and then a few more guns thrown in. I didn't know anything about guns, and now I do. I know a lot about guns. For a clumsy 5 foot nothing Brit, I'm loving it. Yeah.
Sometimes, Mom, you can be a real bitch.
Now, Sarah!
Run!
I'm now dangerous. It's f***ing awesome.
And we cut. Check it.